So the next thing that we want to do to make our network train faster is to use mini batches. So let's make a small review here. What is a batch? What is a mini batch? How does stochastic gradient descent come in here? So first you have the batch gradient descent, right? So what that means is you run the whole data through the network. What mini batch gradient descent means is you run two or more data points through the network, but not all, because if you do all, that means you're using batch gradient descent. So anything that is two or more data examples that you have, or data points, that is less than the whole data point. Stochastic gradient descent is running only one example through the network. So you run them one by one. So you can also say your mini batch size is equal to one, for example. All right, so I'm saying run examples through network, but what do I mean? So let's look into that. We talked about this in the hyperparameters lesson, but I think it cannot hurt to reiterate. So this is our data, let's say. It has 10,000 data points, 10,000 examples, 10,000 lines. Then I determine my mini batch size to be 2,500. So what happens is we're going to divide our data into four, and all of these four little groups are going to have 2,500 examples. Then I'm going to take the first 2,500 examples, feed it into the network, calculate an output. And this output is going to be used to calculate the error, which is basically the output minus the actual values, the values that I have in my test, the values that I have in my y, if you remember. So x is input, y is output. So comparing it with the target output that we wanted to see. And this error is going to be used to update the parameters of the network. So this could be weights of the connections, biases of the nodes, but we can also have other parameters. So whatever parameters we have, this error is going to be used to update the network. Then I'm going to go to the next mini batch, and like nothing happened, I'm going to do the same thing on this already updated network. Run the 2,500 examples, calculate the output, calculate the error, update the network parameters using this error. And then we're going to do the same thing for the next mini batch, same thing for the next mini batch. And once I'm done with the last mini batch, that means I am done with one epoch. So I have done one iteration. The network has seen the whole data set once so far. So this is how it works. If you use stochastic gradient descent, you are going to feed the data into your network one by one. So you're going to feed one example, calculate the output, calculate the error, update the network. Second example, do the same thing. Third example, do the same thing. If you use batch gradient descent, so if you give the whole data set to your network, you're not going to divide it like this. You're going to give the whole data set to your network and do this, and then give the whole data set again. So it's going to be the second epoch, third epoch. You're going to keep going to keep giving all of the data set into your network, calculating the error and updating your network. So this is how it works. So let's see how it looks while it's training. So batch gradient descent is going to have a very smooth learning curve. So let's say this is the number of epochs, so number of times the network or the whole data is run through the network, and this is loss. So when we are doing batch gradient descent, when we are using all of the data, we're going to see a very smooth lowering of the loss. This is a training loss, of course. And if we look at how we're going to be able to find the local minima, so this is what this graph is showing us. Quickly, let's say this one, this dark orange in the outer of this graph is the area where the values of parameter 2 and parameter 1 is going to give us a high cost. The slider area is a bit of a lower cost. Lighter, again, means lower cost, and this lightest area, nearly white, means that it is the optimum, or it is the minimum that we're trying to achieve. So let's say we start in this place, our parameter 1 is initialized here, and parameter 2 is initialized here. So with batch gradient descent, we are able to see this whole area. So this is basically given all of the examples, how the parameter 1 and parameter 2 would affect your cost. And batch gradient descent is able to see all of it. So it's able to clearly see this way is lower weight, this way is lower weight, this way is lower weight. And that's why it is able to find the minimum. For minimize gradient descent, it's a little bit different. So let's talk about the loss function first. What's going to happen is during these epochs, you are going to oscillate a little bit while you're learning, because you are seeing only parts of your data. So you're not seeing all of the data. So these parts of the data, just as your data set does not perfectly represent the real world for you, it is only a subset. Your mini batches, or your batches, the tiny groups that you have of your data, do not perfectly represent all of your data. They are still a subset of your data. So that's why you are going to have some oscillations around. So maybe your first mini batch thinks that this way is actually lower, and the second mini batch will think, no, this way is lower. So you are going to be able to reach the minimum eventually, but you are going to go around a little bit, because all of the mini batches might have different, will be representing a little bit, something a little bit off than the actual data. And while you're learning, of course, some of them is going to give you a better performance, and some of them are going to give you a lower performance. But at the end, you're still going to see a nice curve that is going down, where the loss is going down. With stochastic gradient descent, it's a little bit more chaotic. So, like, you know, if you get a subset of your data, then you're not perfectly representing your data. Now imagine you only have one example from your data. That is not nearly going to represent all of your data. That's why it's going to be very hard for you to find the direction towards the minimum. And what happens with stochastic gradient descent most of the time is that it cannot really find the minimum, even if it's really close to that. It just keeps going around and around, because it does not really have an idea where it is, because we're only giving it one example at a time. So it's very likely that it will not even converge to the minimum amount cost that we're trying to find. A small note here, when I mean converge, what I mean is like finding this minimum point, finding a point where the cost is minimum and our model is aware of this. So let's talk about what their advantages and disadvantages are. So when you are using batch gradient descent, you are not going to oscillate as much while you're going to the minimum, right? You're just going to, you know where it is, and you're going to go there. But the problem with it is one iteration takes a very long time. You are trying to give the network all of your data, and it is trying to calculate everything and update all the parameters of the network using all of the examples, and that takes a very long time. When you use stochastic gradient descent, on the other hand, on the other extreme, you're going to be able to calculate the output very fast, because, you know, you're giving one example, it's going to be lightning fast, and it is oscillating a lot. So even if it gets stuck at a local minima, which is a local minima is a place where it is not the absolute minimum a cost can have, but it's a little bit higher. And the reason it is still a minimum is because, and the graphic might look like this, right? It might go down, up a little bit, and then down again. So this will still look like a minimum to your network while it's learning, because it looks like it's all going down here. But where you actually want to end up is the global minimum, where the cost is absolutely the lowest. So stochastic gradient descent can get out of the local minimum, because, you know, it just goes all over the place. But the problem is it will not converge. So when it doesn't converge, it doesn't really help to be able to get out of a local minima. And another problem is, while we're doing these calculations, we are using vectorization, right? We're not only putting one example into the network, calculating the output. What we're doing is we're giving all of the examples to the network that we want to give, and all of them are put in a vector or a matrix, and they are multiplied by the weight matrix, and then the bias matrix is added to it, and then we calculate the output. But when you use stochastic gradient descent, you give them one by one, so you are not using the gains from using vectorization. Minibatch gradient descent, though, is like the best of both worlds. You oscillate less than the stochastic gradient descent towards the local minima, definitely. you are fast to calculate the output because you're not giving all of the examples, you're only giving a subset of the examples. And it generalizes really well. So when you use batch gradient descent, you might still overfit, but with mini batch gradient descent, it generalizes well, does not overfit most of the time. It is fast because, again, you are giving a lot of examples. You're not giving all of the examples, but you are giving more than one, so you can still use vectorization. Just one thing that does, you know, is not perfect about mini-batch gradient descent, of course, is there is another parameter to tune. So you have to decide what mini-batch size that you want. But let's talk about that now. What should be your mini-batch size? If you are using a small data set, so around a couple of thousand data points, then you can just go ahead and use batch gradient descent because, you know, it's not going to be a very big problem. Your model is not going to be very slow. But if you have more examples, you're better off using mini-batch gradient descent. But still, how should you decide the amount of data points that needs to be in one batch? One rule of thumb is to use mini-batch values that are powers of 2. So this could be, you know, 2 is a bit little, but like 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, and so on and so forth. So basically, values that are powers of 2. Actually, if you remember, we had the lacun initialization from last week or last lesson when we were talking about initialization techniques, and the face behind that initializer tweeted, apparently, I think like either 2 years ago or something, it was about a paper that he wrote about deciding the mini-batch size, and he said, friends don't let friends use mini-batches larger than 32, and I've seen this featured in a lot of places that I thought it was very interesting. So he seems to think that 32 is the absolute highest mini-batch size that you should use. It shouldn't be higher than that. But there's actually some other research done into this, and you can go and find these articles if you're interested in reading the academic articles behind them. But basically what they say is if you're using a learning rate, scheduling, or warming up, then you can use mini-batch sizes as high as 8,192. That is very high, and I don't even know if you would need a mini-batch size that high at any point, but just so you know, some people think that you can use mini-batch sizes much, much higher than 32. But generally, some number between 2 and 512 is typical, so you can use those. But what you want to do is you want to use a number that is going to work for you. So you're going to have to try things. And another thing that's important to know is that you want to use something that's going to fit in your CPU or GPU, that is a processor in your computer or on the cloud, wherever that you're running your network. Because if you use a number that's a little bit too high for your processor, then you're not going to be able to use the whole power of your processor. It's going to be a little bit slower than what it could be. And lastly, basically, what you should do is start with a big number. Start as big as you think you can handle and slowly lower it. Of course, at this point, you're like, okay, what does it mean? How do I know what number I can handle? But I think a good example could be to start with 500 to 12 and then see if the performance is what you expect and lower it, higher it, and see, you know, where you get a better performance. And I think these are the kind of things that you get a feel for after you've done some projects, and it's going to be simpler as you go further in your career to understand what to use.